We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is January 26, 2016, and we're coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com live. I meant to say live before I said on Spreaker.com and on NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. But you can listen live that way. Or you can listen to the archives basically everywhere. Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, and SoundCloud immediately following the show. Also Tumblr, but it's a T-U-M-L-R. I still don't get how to navigate around in Tumblr. So, but if you do and you want to listen to it on Tumblr, you know, go ahead, have fun. We promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, as well as exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. One of the things I just wanted to mention real quick, we are looking for a sponsor to get on a AM radio station in Phoenix, Arizona. That is not my ultimate goal. And I mean that from the standpoint of ultimately, I want to build up an internet radio station. Now, going on an AM station, not permanently, maybe one night a week, and then the rest of the nights I'll be on the same as I'm on now. But then I can at least develop a following. So at least a year, if I could do that, you know, it would depend upon the station, and they might not like me. They might kick me off after 13 weeks, because I think that's what the agreement was, something like that initially. So they could kick me off at any time. But assuming that they liked having me on and everything, you know, maybe a year, year and a half to 2 years, it might be something I want to do. And then after that, go back to the internet with at least some kind of following. And at the same time, continue to build my internet following. Because I like the freedom of the internet. You can say whatever you want. You can do whatever you want. You can do so many different things where I have, which reminds me, I changed the name of one of my pages, the NPLFA, which stands for Nonpartisan Liberty for All. The only reason I use those initials is because I can't fit Nonpartisan Liberty for All. It was never to refer to it as that. People started calling it that, but that's not really why I did that. It's just to shorten the amount of space. But anyway, it's now Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network, because I don't want it to just be radio, and I want people to be thinking about that I'm posting articles, not as many as I wish, more blog type articles where it's just opinion based on the website. And I'm planning on putting up some YouTube videos as well. Right now, the radio show is on YouTube, but there's no video. I mean, there's just a picture, but there's no actual video of the station, or not station, but of the show. So we'll see what happens in the future, but there's so many possibilities. And with the internet, it's all up to me, really, what I want to do and how I want to do it. And I have total control of that. Now, with the station, pretty much what I got from them is, as far as the show goes, that I'm pretty much in control. There is the FCC. And that is my biggest problem right there, that I don't want any regulation. And that would be an issue. But I would be willing to not curse, I guess, for a certain amount of time. But really, the plan would be to build up the internet station and or the internet network and do what I can with it. You know, I mean, I'm looking at this as a long term thing, not something that I expect to have right away. Obviously, I think I started the network officially in October, where we did have another original show. But I'm just being patient, keeping this show going. And as long as I'm keeping this show going, you know, I'm still working on other things in the background. So, but the point was, anyone who knows any marketing agents or marketing directors at any businesses that want to advertise in Arizona, I'm looking for sponsorship on the show. And that way I can try to set something up where I can at least do one night a week, and then I can promote the internet shows as well. So it would be a, and it's a huge station as well, which is a good thing. And being in Phoenix, it's close. I'm sure hotels and casinos would want to market in that area. So just in the event that somebody has, if somebody is in actual in marketing and in charge of advertising or knows somebody, please let me know so I can send some information over. But I just wanted to let everybody know about that. So we'll see where that goes. If we get someone to sponsor the show or not, it will be a big boost to the show, and it will definitely get us to build up the audience. It will give us an opportunity to build up the audience there. So anyway, it's the first day of the week for us, at least on the radio, not the first day of the week, unfortunately, for working. Of course, my week starts Monday, but a lot of stuff to talk about today. A lot of kind of serious and touchy things to talk about. Maybe touchy is not the word, but controversial to an extent. And really what I'm going to do, unlike certain other people, is just come out and explain kind of where I'm coming from with a lot of this and how it doesn't. Usually I don't really focus on race on the show. There's been a couple shows where it comes up. If it comes up, it comes up, whatever. But when it's counterproductive to what I'm trying to accomplish, then it's something I will bring up. And at the moment, what is going on with some of the things out there, they are counterproductive, especially Black Lives Matter, because it's taking away from the police. It really is. It's taking away from all the evil that the police do to just focus on one thing. And we'll get into that detail and also into some of my history briefly. If you listen to some of the other shows, you may know it already, but just so all the listeners have an idea of my history as well, to understand where I'm coming from And then if I have time, I'm going to get into another radio host who's a lot more popular than me, but is not nowhere near a professional. I guess they get money for what they do, so you could say technically a professional, but not professional standards, not even close to it. And the shit they're saying, they might as well be, you know, in the fucking Klan as far as I'm concerned. And that's also to point out the difference between just being honest and disagreeing with some things based on logic and not being brainwashed by political operatives and being just a straight up fucking racist like this other person is. So before we get to that, and we're going to talk about Black Lives Matter as well as white privilege or whatever type of privilege you like to call that. And I really think that's just ridiculous and on so many levels, because there's so many people that have disadvantages. And it all depends. Now, definitely, if you take the average black person and the average white person, I think it's harder for the average black person to be successful. But being harder and not being able to be successful, or the government stopping them from being successful or something along those lines, it's not to that extent. But the truth is, and people want to deny this, that yes, for the average black person, it is a little harder to succeed than the average white person. But I'm just, that's an average, you know, just taking the average person. Now you could take, and I've mentioned this before, take some billionaire son. There are billionaire black people. And well, I don't know any billionaire black people off the top of my head. I don't know that many billionaire white people off the top of my head. All that I can think of is like Trump and Bloomberg because they're in the news. I know Dr. Dre is pretty close to it because of his Beats audio that he sold for. I think he is a billionaire now. But so whatever, take Dr. Dre's son compared to some kid that his father, I don't know, is a manager at a store at the mall. I mean, obviously, in that situation, the black kid has it a lot easier than the white kid. So I'm just taking it as averages. And personally, just so everybody knows, I could give a fuck what race somebody is. I don't identify with any race. I don't feel like I'm connected to any race. I don't feel like, you know, some camaraderie with some race, like, yeah, we're both this, or you know what I mean? I don't feel any of that fucking shit. And people that know me and know my history definitely know that. So I'm different than a lot of people. So my experiences are also a lot different. So I could be looking at things totally differently than I'm probably not the best person to ask about certain things, like something like white privilege. I'm probably the last person you want to ask about something like that, because I haven't had really any privileges. Everything I have, I somehow created myself. Not to say I haven't had any help. I mean, I had parents and they didn't help that much, but I mean, they were there. They gave me a place to live and gave me food. And there's some people who don't even have that. So that's where it goes to, you know, judging people as well. As you're sitting there judging somebody, not knowing how they grew up, what they went through, or any of that stuff. But we'll talk all about that. If you'd like to call in, you can call in at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. And we have a dedicated phone now to the show. Before, I was taking out a fucking SIM card between one phone, but now I actually have a new phone. So the business phone is now a 24-hour phone. So you could call that phone on off hours and leave a message, or if you had a question about the show or anything you wanted to ask about, you can call and leave a message on that number. But that's, and that is also the phone that we use when there's any live show on to answer calls. You can also Skype into the show. Username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send us a contact request with your name, where you're calling from, and what you'd like to talk about. So before we get into our main topic for the evening, there's a couple stories that I'd like to talk about. First, and they've been doing this recently, but I never heard of them doing stuff like this until recently. And when I say recently, you know, maybe past 5 years or less. And that is arresting people for going out during a snowstorm. You'd always have the don't drive advisory. See, this is where the parenting comes in, because obviously, okay, you shouldn't be driving. So what do? You issue an advisory that roads are dangerous. You shouldn't be on the roads. But I don't know if anyone actually got arrested in New York City's where it was issued. It might have been issued in other places, but I had just heard that it was in New York City. And New York City and Long Island and all transit from New Jersey. I don't know what that means, if they're talking about like railroads or something. But you could have been arrested for traveling under this travel ban. And people might look at that and say, well, why is that a big deal that someone's arrested for driving in a snowstorm? They shouldn't be driving in a snowstorm anyway. Fine. Okay. It's the same type of logic that leads to other things. And that's the problem. Yes, we know you shouldn't be, just like a seatbelt law. You could say, well, but it's good for you. And then you take it one step at a time. So it's that same type of logic that says, well, it's bad for you to be out there driving. And yes, we fucking know that. And most people are not going to drive because they know that. But if somebody does, they're going to arrest them. And it was a huge blizzard, I guess, and affected a lot of the East Coast. I don't know if any other place actually put the same thing in effect, that you would be arrested if you were caught driving. But it was a bunch of major cities in the East Coast that were under a snowstorm: Philly, Baltimore, Washington. So essentially, you have the mayor and the governor. They have the power to say that, oh, you can't go out. And they may have a good reason, but that's not the point. The point is, the mayor and the governor are telling you that you cannot go out. Or you can, but you'll be arrested. So it can't be that bad if, I guess you got police cars driving around. So what the fuck are they driving for? So I just wanted to bring that up briefly about the major snowstorm that happened, I guess, over the weekend. I never get snow in Las Vegas, so I don't really think about snow too much. It's just whatever. Hey, it snowed in the East Coast. I guess there was 40 inches in Glengarry, West Virginia. There's the highest snowfall by state. Nantucket, Massachusetts got 4.5. Well, that's not that much at all. D.C. got 18.5. So JFK Airport, New York got 20.4. But they banned the whole city, I guess, from there's a travel ban for the whole city. And, of course, in this story, it doesn't talk about being arrested because they don't want to portray that. At least I didn't see it in the article. But I did hear that you would be arrested in New York City if you were caught traveling, which it creates a hassle. They'll tow your car. They'll, you know, give you a big fine. And I know you got those fucking people that say, well, what about if you got in an accident? Are you caused an accident? Well, first of all, if no one else is on the road, I guess, what does it matter, right? And then if you hit something, it's probably going to be like a tree or, you know, some inanimate object, and you took the risk, so you're responsible for what happens. And I don't know what the fuck has happened to self-responsibility, where every time something happens, they want to blame something else. I forget what it was that I was listening to early today, but they wanted to blame not the person who actually did it, but the religion or the whatever, you know, blame gun manufacturers for creating a gun. Like you can't do that with a 3D printer now. You know, for people that don't know, if you have a 3D printer, which you can probably get one for $1,000, you can literally print a gun. It's a shitty fucking gun, and it will only fire one bullet, but, I mean, you can do it. So it's just a bunch of bullshit. Also, another story I wanted to talk about, Lena Dunham, that fat fucking bitch on, what's that show that she's on? I can't remember the show. I just think the show should be called Fat. It had, I don't know if he's still on it, but the Adam somebody from the new Star Wars movie. Why can't I think of his name now? But Girls, she wrote this show, Girls, that's on HBO. And she comes out, and this article is about, really, they split it up into like four paragraphs, but each paragraph is like a sentence. She's coming out and, of course, saying that the media coverage on Hillary Clinton is rabidly sexist. And I don't know what the fuck she's talking about. I don't know where that's the whole thing, is she just comes out and says, oh, it's sexist. But does it say where, what channel it was on? Was it something specific? No, it's just sexist because she's a woman and women are treated that way. I don't have to have any evidence or anything. I just say she's a woman, women are treated that way, it's sexist. Everything's sexist and discriminatory and racist and everything. And no one's responsible for anything they fucking do, I guess. That's what, I guess, how things are. But it didn't say, like, she got this kind of coverage here. So if you read the article, I guess it's coverage anywhere. Anywhere she got coverage, it was bad coverage. Nobody gave her any type of good coverage. Well, I mean, I don't know how much good coverage you can get when you have all these scandals going on at the same time as well, but whatever. But I didn't see any sexist coverage. It's like they're trying to build that vote for Hillary because she'll be the first woman. You know, we just had the first black president, then the first woman president, then, you know, they'll have to have the first transsexual president soon because it's not like it matters anyway who the president is because they don't run really shit anyway. It's all run for them. But then everybody can be happy and celebrate. Hey, we have the first woman president. We have the first tranny president. We have the first president with boobs and a dick, and make people happy. The last article I wanted to cover has to do, oh Jesus, I'm looking at the picture here. It's like this big giant cat trying to eat this little girl. It has to do with curing fear, and they talk about a drug to cure anxiety, and of course, I mean, there's tons of them out there anyway, but really what it goes into is for things like PTSD and other anxiety disorders, actually getting rid of memories. And I read about this before. I don't know if I talked about it on the show. It says, because the first thing a lot of people probably think of is in the movie Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, where people would go and erase their memories of their ex so they wouldn't have them anymore and they wouldn't be all depressed about them and whatever. So they're saying it's not like that, but it kind of erases the memory of your fear of them, or you know that you feared them, but the fear goes away. I don't know. Anything when you get into fucking with people's brains, there's a lot of shit that you can do. And just from, okay, well, you have this fear, we're going to go in your brain and get rid of this fear. And you don't know what else they're fucking getting rid of during that process as well. What part of your brain they're fucking with. So, of course, you know, they're doing all their testing and whatever, but that doesn't really mean shit. So, anyway, from what I get out of this, it's just tampering with human memory and still knowing that you were. I'm trying to think of how to explain it or how I understand it, is that it's like you know that you were afraid of spiders, but your memory of how you got afraid of spiders and why you were afraid of spiders is gone, and you're no longer afraid of spiders. And I guess if it's something, I mean, you can look at the positive side if you have PTSD, especially people in the military, but I don't trust anything that, again, at this point, everything is sanctioned via the government. So I would be, you know, and of course I'm overly paranoid, but I have a lot of reasons to be. I wouldn't have any operation that would be fucking with my brain, I guess, unless for some reason I had to have brain surgery or, you know, I was going to die or something and I had no choice. Like if I just passed out and had a stroke and they had to perform brain surgery or something. But besides that, I wouldn't. You know, even something like Alzheimer's disease, which at some point with the stem cell research and the way they're able to regenerate cells, I'm sure that the technology will be there. I mean, I don't know when, but I would say that the technology will be there to essentially repair anything in the next 50 to 100 years, if even that long. I don't know if you're dead and they show up after you're dead. But at some point, I think that will be the case as well. Will they be able to regenerate things after you're even dead? But I would say in probably in the next 50 years that they'll be able to regenerate all these cells. So as I was talking about last week about a cure for multiple sclerosis that this woman who couldn't walk anymore, where it got that bad because it's a disease that keeps getting worse, where she could finally walk again. And that was because of stem cells. That's why things like, I mean, this doesn't bother me anyway, but trying to ban stem cell research on embryonic stem cells is just, why? How does that, these fucking religious people, man, are just, that's one thing that out of all the countries in the world, they want to talk about guns, right? Out of all the countries in the world, this doesn't happen anyplace else. And it does, so you're a fucking liar. But out of all the countries in the world, no, I can't say all of them because you got all the Muslim countries that are pretty fanatical. But out of all like the, and this is what they said too, because obviously all the Muslim countries got a bunch of guns and they're shooting and killing people too. So out of all, I guess, the, what would you call them, westernized countries or first world countries, or there's a word I'm looking for that I can't think of, sophisticated countries, but that wasn't the word I was looking for. The United States seems to still be the most fanatical when it comes to religion, and they're not that bad. But there's still, you know, Europe has loosened up on that. I mean, Europe was never caught up on sex, it seems, at least since I've been alive. I mean, I don't know what it was like before that, or at least since I've been old enough to realize it, that Europe never seemed to be caught up on things like alcohol or sex. So why they all got caught up on drugs except for like Amsterdam, I don't know. But the main reason why the U.S. got so caught up on fucking sex was religion. And they were religious, I guess, in all these other countries. I mean, I think the most religious were the Irish Catholics, man. I think they... the Italians, maybe because that's probably the biggest percentage that came to the U.S. I don't know. But anyway, maybe it's the Catholics that are so. I mean, I don't really know a lot about all these different sects of Christianity. So I can't really say, but I know that at least under that umbrella that there's some that are worse than others and some that are more fanatical than others and that still can't fucking just let go. It's like if you want to practice that for your own life, fine, but they can't just let go of still pushing shit on other people or getting involved in stuff that they should have no involvement. So anyway, that's all the stories I have for today. Before we get to our main topic, I will take a break. If you'd like to call in again, 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. And if you'd like to Skype in, just send a contact request to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. It's all one word. And your name, where you're calling from, and what you want to talk about. Oh, and if you can, also put how you heard about the show. Because that'd just be interesting for me. How you heard the show or heard about the show. If it's somebody I know that's calling in, then obviously I know how you heard about the show. But if it's assuming it's somebody I don't know. And if you do call in, the best way or the fastest way to get in would just be, instead of calling, just text that I'm trying to get on the air, my name's whatever, and then I won't screen the call, because that will be my screening. So I'll just pick it up, and then, you know, if it's a prank call or you start yelling at me, I'll just hang it up. It's easy to just hang it up. All right. Well, we'll be right back after this. We'll be talking all about Black Lives Matter, as well as white privilege, and a little about the police and how really that's taken a background. And that is what is bothering me. That's where I think I really come in on this, is it's taking a background and to it. And you have a group that really isn't just about the police anymore. And if they want to have their own group, you know, that's perfectly fine. But come out and be honest about what it is. Anyway, we'll be right back after this nonpartisan Liberty for All. Check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, and check us out on Facebook, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com, as well as And the Government Police and NPLFA Media and Radio Network.
Continues his campaign against Black Lives Matters in this clip, but for the first time in a long time, not all of his guests are playing along.
In back segment tonight, so far this year, 22 police officers have been killed by gunfire in America. Some believe that's in response to a number of black men being shot by the cops. In Bexar County, Texas, there's a video showing 41-year-old Gilbert Flores being shot to death by two police officers. The cops say Flores was armed, but no weapon is seen in the video. That doesn't mean anything, of course. And that kind of incident is seized upon by Black Lives Matter and other radical groups to demonize the police. Do you believe that the Black Lives Matter crew and other radicals are igniting violence against cops?
I think they're making the police job tougher, but the police, I think the police can handle that. It's always been a tough job. But no, I don't think there's not a result of cops getting killed from Black Lives
Matter. Okay, so despite the provocative pigs in a blanket and all of this business, and every time there is a controversy about an officer shooting a black person, they're out there stirring the pot. You don't feel that disturbed individuals watch this and then act out?
There are fewer cops shot this year than last year. Are you willing to give Black Lives Matter credit for that? Cop shootings are down.
I know they're down slightly.
About 17%.
But in August, they're up.
Ever since this. It was a bad month.
Yeah, it was a bad month.
The month before, there were none.
Right.
I mean, overall, they're down.
Okay.
So I don't see an epidemic there.
You don't often see someone on his show both presenting information that's directly contrary to what he's saying and not having their mic be cut. So that was interesting.
He didn't have a chance to go, cut his mic!
Cut it! Get him the fuck out. Shoot him!
You have to. I'm going to be the one who stops him. All right, so let's break that down. It was a little muffled at the end, so I want to make sure you understand. O'Reilly said, yeah, but they're up in August. And he said, yeah, that's because there was zero in July. There was no cop shot in July.
Yeah.
So when you say it's up in August, that means there was one as opposed to zero, right? At least one. So and the professor there was making a point, hey, overall they're down 17% from last year. So if Black Lives Matter has got everybody riled up, why are there less cop shootings?
Yeah,
there is no answer to that.
Be at zero if not for Black Lives Matter. Now, unfortunately, you have seen in the past week, obviously, there have been a couple of tragedies where cops have been murdered. That is the case. So that has actually shifted the numbers from what the criminal justice professor was talking about right there. We have the updated numbers. As of Monday, 24 officers have been shot and killed in the line of duty this year compared to 23 at the same point last year. Because, as again, in 1 week, we had two. And when the number is as small as 24, that can really throw it off. O'Reilly did not mention that 500 people were shot dead by officers by July 10th this month. Now, that was months ago. I've seen recent numbers as high as 799. And so you can, of course, understand why O'Reilly would be much more concerned about 24 officers shot by criminals than almost 800 people, including many civilians, being shot by people who are not supposed to be killing people.
Because he's an arrogant douchebag.
So here's the thing. Since we're decent people, at least we like to think so, we care about both. We hate that 24 cops got shot
and killed.
Of course,
yeah.
Right? We don't want anybody shot and killed. So, but we also hate the, even if you take the conservative number, 500 in half a year, basically. 500 people shot and killed by cops. Now, were they all unjustified? No. I'm sure in some cases the guy pulled a gun and the cop had to shoot him to save his own life. That happened. Of course that happens, right? And so, but is it a shame that, a human being died? Yes. And now some of them are obviously not justified. We cover that on the show all the time. And it's okay to say that's also a shame.
Yes.
But when you have the O'Reillys of the world and they say, 24 cops killed, that's a disaster, the worst thing that's ever happened, it's all the protesters' fault. What are they protesting about? Oh, 500 people got shot and killed by the cops. That I don't give a shit
about.
Don't care about those lives at all. And then he's confused why they call it Black Lives Matter.
Yeah.
So they're saying, hey, we already get that you think cops' lives matter. You care a lot about those lives. All we're doing is asking you to also care about the black lives that are lost. And yes, of the 500 or the 800 so far this year, isn't that a stunning number?
Yeah.
A disproportionate number of them are black and minorities. In fact, 2/3 of the people who are shot when they're unarmed, hence not a threat, are minorities.
Yeah.
2/3. That's why they say Black Lives Matter.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. The first thing I wanted to say about this, because I realize I did title it too. I didn't title anything about the police, but that they do nothing but divide people, which they do. But I think that's totally a government plan. And I'll get into more detail later, but I know somebody who went to one of these rallies that was hijacked by a Democratic operative, and they have them all over the place. We're getting to the point where you don't know who the fuck you can trust anymore. And I'm not talking about just little things. I'm talking about that you're friends with somebody for years, and then you find out they're like a government agent, doesn't necessarily mean that they were targeting you. And maybe they were at first, or maybe they just, you know, needed to fit in and they became friends with you or something. But there are so many government agents now, and you're just going to see the deficit's going to go up. Oh, the debt and the deficit. And someone had done this before, so let me do it as well, because I like this person, also feel that people don't know the difference. The deficit is for the year. So essentially, if for this year they extort $4 trillion worth of taxes from, you know, a variety of areas, and the budget's $5 million, the deficit is $1 trillion because they needed $5 and they only got $4. And then that $1 trillion goes over to the debt, which right now is like 20 something trillion. So then if it's 21 trillion right now, then it would be 22 trillion. So they're not paying down the debt, period. They can't even balance the year. So before they start paying down the debt, they're only paying the interest. That's what only paying the interest. They're basically doing the worst possible thing you can do, like an idiot that gets out of college and basically what happened with the housing market, where people got the no interest loans. I got one too, like a dumbass, and paid the interest, and that's all you can afford. And you're paying. I was in a little different situation. I could barely afford it, but it was still stupid because I was overextending myself. But there were people that couldn't even afford it once it went up. They got like an arm or whatever, and the interest rates went from like 5% to like 10% 3 years later. But anyway, they don't really tell you that. And essentially what the government is doing is really fucking stupid and a bad example. But that one of the biggest things, and the more I listen to this stuff, where I listen to different videos and different people talk, I realize how this separates people and how people really have a lot of the same things in common when it comes to their issues with the government. But at the same time, you have people becoming part of this party or that party, or instead of just saying, fuck you, government, and promoting noncompliance and all of us getting together, it's well, we're going to do this. And we're going to support this party because it says we should, and we're going to follow the government, even though we don't like them and they've done this stuff to us. And it's just, they love that it separates people. They love that it gives people something else to talk about. So, like, while I'm wasting my time talking about this, and I don't think I am wasting my time because I have a point, and my point is to bring people together and to bring up the police and how they're being kind of left out of this. So I do have a point that relates to freedom and liberty. Otherwise, I wouldn't do it because that's the whole point of my show. But it really shows when you listen to some of these videos or, well, they're really YouTube videos, and I'm just playing the audio, that if people really just talked to each other and talked about some of these things. Now, I'm taking my, I guess the whole thing here is I'm taking it from my perspective, but I know people that agree with me. So, and I'm friends with, you know, people from all races, and my fiance's Mexican, and I mean, I think she could kind of care less about a lot of this stuff. Not that she, I would say she cares less, but she's more, she doesn't want to deal with it because it's scary when some of the stuff that we get into, it is scary because it's provable facts about what the government's doing, and you can prove it from their own documents and all of this shit. But anyway, it's easy for me to at least see. It's sad that the people involved don't see it. But I think a lot of the people that are involved in Black Lives Matter aren't really involved in Black Lives Matter. They're involved in the whole fight against the police. They're not actually part of the whole Black Lives Matter movement. Because I went to their website, and they're about a lot more. And if they want to be for that, you know, hey, that's fine. I don't agree with them, but that's fine. But don't make it into a whole thing about standing up against the police, because really what they're saying, they're in a way, I wouldn't say they're necessarily contradicting themselves, but to a point they are. So first, I just want to get into my history briefly. I did a show a couple weeks ago about the history of hip hop and talked a little about my life and how I grew up and stuff like that. So, I mean, I grew up experiencing a lot of racism from both races, actually, more from white people, because I used to hang out with all the black kids. I had my hair braided. You know, they called me wannabe nigga and stuff like that. There was a couple black people that didn't like the fact that I was like that, and they just try to, just a couple people specifically that I'm thinking of, you know, that would fuck with me or whatever. But I ended up getting into a fight with. But for the most part, it was more white people, at least in high school. And then after it was, I think, more black people, because I think the white people didn't know who I was in high school. They did. So they thought they could get away with shit like that. But then when I started hanging out with all the black kids, they were actually scared of them, whatever. But anyway, my point being is that I'm not your average white person. On my father's side, he's Jewish. I don't know if that makes a difference, but there's still a lot of anti-Semitic people. And I have a different experience than I think than with most people. I mean, everything that I have or everything I accomplished, I feel like I pretty much accomplished it myself. I mean, I had some help, but not a lot. And that's where, when that white privilege comes in, not that anybody's ever said that to me, but it's like, you don't fucking know me. So for you to judge me, because that's what you're doing. I know they try to explain, well, it means this. It's like, no, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. You can try to say whatever the fuck you want that it means. But what you're saying is you had some kind of privilege to where you to get to where you are. And some people have, and some black people have, and it's not all white people. There's plenty of poor ass white people. The majority of people that are on welfare are white people. There's more of them. So that's one of the reasons. But there's a bunch of redneck, poor ass, you know, missing teeth fucking white people that are on welfare. So, you know, that's why government media is such bullshit. And there's plenty of black people that are successful, that have a good job, that take care of their kids, but you don't see that on government media. So they love to help to push those stereotypes on government media. They love to do it. And that's what the government wants. And there's reasons why they want it. Just like in the 60s or 70s, whenever the war on, I think 60s with Johnson and the war on poverty, where they wanted women to not have a husband. Oh, we can give you welfare. We can, you know, have a bunch of more fucking kids. And if you look at the stats, and I've never seen the stats, this is what I've heard from a number of historians, that if you look at the stats, after this whole war on poverty, that more and more kids were born out of wedlock. There were black people did worse financially. I mean, even now, with white people as well, I think it's like 25%. I heard today, and I don't know how accurate this stat is. I'm going to assume it is, but it sounded kind of high for black people. It said 25% of white people kids are born out of wedlock, and 75% of black people. That seemed kind of high. So I don't know that that's true or not. I want to attribute that to somebody, but I listen to so much shit, I forgot where I had heard that. But I had also talked about in the past that, you know, this whole, well, you're in a Hispanic community and you're in the black community, and just because you're black or just because you're Hispanic, that there's so many mixed communities. And I was using Las Vegas as an example, and I should do an actual study and see what percentage of black people and Hispanic people, and I bet you there's a higher percentage of Hispanic people actually, just from living here, that it does seem like that there's a bigger Hispanic community. But that the majority of black people that live in Las Vegas are living in mixed areas, like where I live at, which is a mixed area, where, you know, a lot of places in Vegas are mixed areas. Summerlin's the only one I can think of that's, you know, parts of Summerlin, I think, that are heavily white, but they're all mixed areas. And I live in a pretty good area, and it's a, you know, it's a mixed area. So all that bullshit, you know, basically when people are talking about a lot of this shit, they're talking about black communities, like solely black communities. And it's like when they're talking about Chicago and people getting shot, the people that live in those neighborhoods are not the majority of black people that live in Chicago. It's the people that live in the fucking ghetto. It's the people that live in the bad neighborhoods. And that's not the majority of people. But they want you to think it's the majority of people. They want you to think every black person is, you know, some gangster. And then you have, you know, the black kids in the suburbs, just like the white kids in the suburbs, you know, dressing like that. And then they get mistaken. Mistaken's not the word, but then police treat them the same way. And they're like, oh, you want to be like, you know, the real gangsters up in the city or up in the projects or whatever. So many of the police, I would say, I've said this before, I view police or the institution as racist, as long as well as the what I call the injustice system. I think that's where black people are screwed over, because whether you're from a good family or a bad family, or live in a nice neighborhood or a bad neighborhood, or you're somebody who, you know, gets in a lot of trouble but maybe just didn't get caught, they're going to look at you the same way. And I think police look at black people. This is the problem, I think. I don't think police necessarily hate black people. I think you have some that do. I don't think police necessarily hate black people. I think they stereotype them, and they think that all young black kids are criminals. So if you're dressing, you know, a certain way, and it's really just how kids dress, man, and it doesn't matter. You could be in the suburbs or in the city or whatever, and they're going to look at them like criminals. I think really at this point, even white kids that dress like that, like how I dressed when I was a kid, to an extent, even now when I'm not like dressed up, you know, where I got my jeans and like a football jersey on or something, you know, they'll look at that as like I'm a criminal or something. So, and I guess if it's dark, I can, you know, I look a little Hispanic because my little, you know, goatee mustache thingy going on there as well, I guess. But focusing on race is really dividing people, and it's counterproductive to promoting the ideas of freedom and liberty. And I had said this before, that I don't focus on that. I focus on an issue. So if people are getting killed by police, even if it's all black people, I focus on the issue of we need to do something about the police, which I think we should just get rid of them altogether. That is my I don't think police should exist. I don't. There are other ways to keep people safe and protect them. And I could talk about that, and I have before, but, you know, this really isn't the time to talk about that. But I would say that I don't think police should exist. And I think the purpose of police is to keep people safe and protect them, and they don't do that. They're too busy filling the jails and filling arrest quotas and making money by handing out, you know, tickets and citations. So I also think all police are bad, and I went into why before, so I'll do it real quick for everybody so they understand why I think all police are bad. And the reason why is all police go in with one idea, not with one idea, but with the knowledge that they're going to have to arrest people for drugs. So anybody who realizes what self-ownership is, that you own your body and you own yourself, and then a cop is going to just rip you off the street, kidnap you, throw you in a cage for choosing what to put in your own body, is a kidnapper. That's just plain and simple to me. And if you're going to join the police knowing that you have to do that, and all cops have to do that, except for maybe if you're a homicide detective or something like that. But to get there, you had to go through being a patrolman. So you had to do it. So, and you probably had to do worse if you've already gone through that. So it was probably worse than even what cops do now. So I would say that all cops are bad. Not just because of that, that's part of it. My experience with cops, my research on cops, the type of people that are attracted to the job, and then all of the things that they have done that are public. So I don't base it off of one thing, but what really gets to being able to say all are bad is that all arrest people for drugs, possession of drugs, which is something they have the right to do, and they're kidnapping people. So all cops are kidnappers that lock people up in cages. A lot of them are corrupt, if you've seen Serbico, and that was in the fucking 70s. So this is nothing new. That's the problem, too, that people think that this is because you have a certain population of people that just believe whatever the fuck they see on in the media, on the main channels, you know, CBS, NBC, ABC, Fox. That's all they believe for the most part, or CNN or one of the news channels. So they don't question. And I question to the fucking extreme. If a cop comes out and says, well, he ran at me with a knife, how the fuck do you know that? Just because a cop said it? What is a cop? A cop is somebody who is able to pass a background check and get through the fucking academy. They are nothing special. They are like everybody else, except for the fact that they're worse, because most of them are attracted to the job because of the power. You do have some that somewhere in there, I guess, they want to do something good, but they know they got to arrest people for drugs. But and that's just one thing. I mean, they have to arrest people for things that don't hurt anybody else, and they knowingly go into it and do that. So somehow they have more credibility in a courtroom, but there's nothing that puts them above anybody else except the fact that the fucking government gives them a bunch of people that will back them up with a whole bunch of guns. That's it. So that's my, and people that have listened to the show before know this, that's my opinion on the police. And I think police go around murdering people all the time, get away with it. And we know that because if we look at the websites that track the killings of, or killings by police, like Killed by Police, which is on Facebook and they have their own website. I think last year it was like 1,100 people. So we know they're killing people. And if you look at this, the specifics, and I went through one time, I went through maybe 50 or 100. It's the same pattern. Like I remember reading this one where a guy had a BB gun and supposedly he pointed it at a cop and he was just sitting in his car and a cop came over. It's just like this bullshit. Like that wasn't planted, or he didn't have a BB gun somewhere in the car and then the cop fucking put it in his hand. It's just, it's ridiculous. And anything with a knife is real easy. Oh, he ran at me with a knife. I just seen it. If people have seen the movie Internal Affairs, it was on cable a couple of days ago. Oh, he ran at me with a knife. They planted a knife on him. So I don't think cops should exist. I don't think they should have the power that they have. I'll just briefly say that there should be security, and security that focuses on protecting and keeping people safe that people actually pay for. And then the people that can't afford it, you know, they help them out. And there's something like that in Detroit. It's called the Detroit Threat Management Center. And I'm so glad that they've done what they've done. And I've had the owner on the show before, because they've given us an example and a template of how to get rid of the police and actually do it in a viable way, not just some bullshit. So there's my take on the police. And I've seen, looking at all these statistics and looking through individual killings, I've seen plenty of black people that were unarmed that were killed by police, white people, Hispanic people, all kinds of people that have been killed by police. And my problem is, it's not the race. It could have been all black people. It could have been all white people. It could have been all Hispanic people. It's people getting killed by the police is my problem. My problem is that the police have the power that they have. People don't just get killed by police. They get harassed by police. They get beaten by police. They get arrested for things they didn't do. And trust me, most of those things have happened. They get guns put to their head for nothing. And I've had that happen too. So to sit there and say that this only happens to black people, or it's not about the police, it's about being black. You know, yes, as I mentioned earlier, I admit that, you know, it's harder to be in general. It's harder to make it as a black person than as a white person in general. Now, it depends on your specific circumstances, but in general, it's harder. But at the same time, you know, in police, I think the same with police, that, as I said, I think they think all black people are criminals. So even with police, I think black people get targeted more. But that doesn't mean that they don't target other people. And what pisses me off is you have a group going around. They're only talking about the black people that were killed by the police. They're not talking about that the problem is the police. They're just talking about, well, the problem is that black people are getting killed. And if that's your issue, if your issue is black people are getting killed, we don't give a fuck about anybody else who's getting killed. We just give a fuck about black people who are getting killed. Okay, fine. And that's your right to do that. But don't twist it around and turn it into, well, this is about not just black people getting killed. It's about, you know, they're twisting it into black people getting killed by the police and turning it into the issue is racism with the police. That's the issue. Now, I'm not saying that is not an issue, because that is an issue. But the issue are the police themselves. And now the police are in the background. If you see what this fucking group has done to take the focus off of the police, it's unbelievable. Because that's where the focus should be, on these fucking police that are killing people. But not even just that they're killing people, all the other shit they're doing to people. If you go back 50 to 60 years, or even 10 to 20 years, you can't tell me that black people don't have more opportunities than they've ever had. And that, yes, there is still racism, but not the type of racism there was 50 or 60 years ago. There's not black people being beaten and murdered for being black. I'm sure there's been fights that have happened between black kids and white kids that may have had something to do with it. There's also a lot of white kids being beat up by black kids because they're white as well. And if you read the book, what was it, White Girl Bleed a Lot, where it actually cited every fucking YouTube video and every article that it got it from. And it was basically, a lot of it was hidden because they didn't want to put that out there. But see, now I'm even going into, I'm not mad at anybody. I'm not even mad at the group Black Lives Matter. I'm sure, although I think the people that are heading the group, and I'll tell you why in a minute, the groups that get attention like this, unless they have somebody fucking famous in them, they get the attention because they have political backers and they have financial backers. That's why. That's exactly why. They have, as I mentioned, they have, people from the Democratic operatives, from the Democratic Party, and they also have somebody funding them. Otherwise, nobody would really know who they are, or it would just die out. And that's why. Now, in their own words, this is not about Black people getting killed by police. And if it was, you know, that's fine, even though I think it still takes the focus off the police. I still don't think it benefits. If the goal is to stop the police from doing what they're doing, I don't think that helps, because you want to show as many instances as possible that the police are out of control. You don't want to limit it to just Black people. And yes, more Black people are getting killed by police percentage-wise, in terms of percentage of the population, than white people. I think as a number, more white people are getting killed, but there are a much higher percentage of the population where Black people are only 12 or 13% of the population. But if your goal was to go after the police, you'd want to show what was going on with everybody. Now, you could focus on, yes, they go after more Black people, and that's fine. But the goal is not to go after police, because it's a group that's been hijacked. That's been, it might not even be hijacked. It might have been started by people with money that are funding it, you know, the secret funders and the Democratic operatives. And I, like I had said earlier, and I don't know if I finished it, they had a rally here for Michael Brown, and it was taken over by the Democratic operatives of the Democratic Party. And you know what? It's the only rally that I know of in Las Vegas that had anything to do with anti-police or freedom. Well, they really weren't too anti-police neither, but anything to do with anything like that, that got any fucking news coverage, period. That's it. Nothing else. Nothing else that had anything to do with freedom. None of the protests at the police station, none of them. But this one did. Why? Well, we know why. Because money and these fucking in the political aspect. So Black Lives Matter is not about police and Black people getting killed by police. And because of that, they're contradicting themselves totally. Because if it was, you'd have to look at all the murders where Black people kill Black people. And I looked at the FBI statistics for 2014, and I'm not trying to put down Black people or anything like that at all. That's not the goal. But 50% of the people that were killed by Black people. They're 13% of the population. Now, again, I think the majority of Black people are hardworking, you know, family-oriented people. Because the amount of murders, I think, were like 11,000-something. So you look at the amount of murderers, and it was 5,000-something. So, you know, when you have people that, what would be the estimated black population would be 12 million? No, I got to have that wrong. Because 10% of 300 million, no, it would be 30 million. So like 30-something million. So 5,000 out of 30-something million doesn't mean nothing, anything. It means that an overwhelming majority of black people are good people. However, you have a small amount, and the small amount that the government media focuses on wants you to think that all black people are like this, and that's what they do. But nobody's talking about, and see, when they said this before, it pissed me off, because when you had the people that just came out and said, you know, we're talking about police killing black people, and then they brought up, well, what about all the black people killing each other? It doesn't relate to, one thing does not relate to the other. Government killing people and people, private citizens killing each other, it does not relate. So if you come out against the government killing people and you don't come out against other people killing other people, it doesn't mean anything. I think that the people that said that was bullshit. But when you come out and say the name of your group is Black Lives Matter, and from your website, this is what their goal is. It says Black Lives Matter is a unique contribution that goes beyond extrajudicial killings of black people by police and vigilantes. So it's not just about police. It goes beyond the narrow nationalism that can be prevalent within some black communities, which merely call on black people to love black, live black, and buy black, keep straight something black men in front of the movement, while our sisters, queer and trans and disabled folk, which if you want to look at the quote unquote black community, and I'm talking about black neighborhoods, aren't the most accepting of gay and trans people, take up roles in the background or not at all. Black Lives Matter affirms the lives of black, queer, and trans folk, disabled folk, black undocumented folks, folks with records, women, and all black lives along the gender spectrum. It centers those that have been marginalized within the black liberation movements. It is a tactic to rebuild the black liberation movement. So fine, if that's what their goal is, that's fine. However, if you come out and say something like that, then you are held accountable for what about black people, all the black people killing black people, which is a huge number. That's where you, and you know what? The numbers have been going down too. So you think of why now, and that's what I think of. Why now? Police have been killing people since police became police. And a lot of times they'd hide it. And I'm sure they killed hundreds of thousands of black people if you go back to the beginning of police. And I'm not an expert in when they went from just like kind of a sheriff to police departments and all that. But I'm sure they killed a lot. And I'm sure they killed a lot of people in general. But if you're saying that, okay, this isn't about police, this is about black people and black lives in general, then they should be addressing black people killing black people. And that should be addressed probably way before all the other shit is, if that's what their goal is. It all depends on what your goal is. Because my goal is to make sure that the government doesn't go around killing people, especially unarmed people that aren't doing anything, no matter what their color is. But my goal is not to stop people from killing each other, because that's not something I, you know, it's not something I could even handle at this point. And I think it's partially the government who loves the fact that black people are killing black people. I'm sure they do. But if that's what they want to do, then that's fine. But what they're doing is exactly what I didn't want to happen and what I talked about when I talked about Michael Brown, the one division having a incident where it was easy to debate. They could have easily argued, you know, well, we think this happened, we think this happened, when there were so many other black people killed by police where there, you couldn't really debate much at all. Because the whole goal was, this is not their goal, obviously, but for me and for a lot of people, is for both white, black, Hispanic, everybody to see the police for what they are. And to get together based on that. I mean, you can get together based on a lot of things that the government does. But that's a start. To get together based on what the police are doing, what they're doing to black people, what they're doing to people in general. And not just killing, but all the other things they're doing. But then Black Lives Matter steps in, and the police literally go to the fucking background. It goes into a racism thing, not a fucking problem with the police thing. And again, I admit that there's some racism in there, but it doesn't matter. The police could stop killing all black people tomorrow. They're still going to be fucking killing people. So is that the goal? Oh, well, as long as they don't kill black people, that's fine. Let them fucking kill everybody else. No, it's... And again, like I said, it's not just killing. Killing, unfortunately, that's probably the least amount, you know, it 1,100 or 1,200 of the bad things they do. It's one of the smallest amounts. Now, it's the worst thing because the person is dead. But what I'm saying is things like harassment and beating people up and things like that. If you're saying 1,200 people get murdered, I'm sure, you know, 20,000 get beat up or something like that. But that's getting ignored because now the focus is like no one cares about all the other people that they're killing. And not that it matters to me that, well, white people got overlooked. I mean, tons of people are getting overlooked. Plenty of black people are getting killed and it's getting overlooked too. You've only had about 4 or 5 people, if that. I mean, what was a big story? Michael Brown was a big story. That's before that, people think like the cops didn't kill anybody. Seriously. Because before that, it was like, you know, nobody said anything. It's almost like this whole thing was set up by the government, and I don't think it actually was, but I think they used everything they possibly could to turn this into what they turned this into, in order to not have to come down on the cops, or if they do have to do something about the cops, to nationalize the police. So, also on their website is how did they come together? And they came together on something that had nothing to do with the fucking police. Nothing. And Trayvon Martin. And Trayvon Martin is a perfect case of the government being able, the Democrats at least, being able to push their perfect little agenda of anti-gun and anti-self-defense. Now, did Trayvon Martin deserve to die? Of course not. He didn't do anything where he deserved to die. But from the evidence in the case, can you find George Zimmerman guilty if you actually watch the case? In my mind, no, because there's no one that is able to say that he wasn't attacked. And it's unfortunate that that happened. And if you look at the actual picture, not the picture of the little 12-year-old, but of the 17-year-old, he was bigger than George Zimmerman. Now, I'm not trying to defend George Zimmerman. It has nothing to do with the people. And again, it's unfortunate that the 17-year-old had to die. But people put so much emotion into things instead of looking at facts and looking at really what happened. So what happens from that is, well, now what we're going to do is try to get this, let's get rid of this law, the stand your ground law, which wasn't even used in the case. But someone tried to come up with this idea of, well, it wasn't used in the case, but if it wasn't for the law, that wouldn't be in their head that they can defend themselves. Some ridiculous shit. And they use that same explanation for this fucking lunatic who killed Jordan Davis. And obviously, that guy went to jail. He should have went to jail. But that had nothing to do with stand your ground. That had to do with a guy just shooting at a car. But somehow, they got stand your ground into it. The reason why is because they don't, they being the government doesn't want you to be able to defend yourself. And the government doesn't want you to be able to have a gun either. They want to disarm the public. They want you to not be able to defend yourself. So no matter how unfortunate and tragic it is, it was a self-defense case. There was some weird stuff that went on. But based on the evidence, it was a self-defense case. And if somebody is sitting there hitting you, beating you, you have the right to shoot them. Now, I think one part of it is, too, is that, you know, if kids, when they're younger, they go and do something stupid like break into somebody's house or steal their car or do this or do that, and the kids end up getting shot, they want the people that shot them held responsible. And you can't have it that way. Your house is your house. And if somebody breaks into your house, they need to know that they could get killed over it. Now, they don't deserve to necessarily get killed over it. It depends on what their reason was. Like if somebody broke in you know, unarmed and they were just trying to, you know, steal a couple of things, it doesn't mean they deserve to die. But if they do, it was because of their actions. And that's also a deterrent. If people knew that if they broke in somebody's house, that they, it's very possible that they're going to get killed, I'm sure break-ins would go down in a certain areas, I'm sure they have. And if people knew that if they just hit people, that they were going to get shot, they might just walk away. And no one's really thought of that in that case. So, you know, again, I look at this George Zimmerman and I don't know what the fuck he was doing. I guess they had break-ins, but if he wasn't hit, if he didn't have bruises on him, and somebody didn't testify that Trayvon Martin was on top of him, then obviously he would have been found guilty in that case because there's no evidence of self-defense. But going back to that case, that had nothing to do with the police. Now, if he was a cop, I would look at it totally differently because cops are trained to deal with that shit. And that's the whole fucking difference. Cops are given these powers. Cops are given all these rights. So if in the Trayvon Martin case, if it was a cop, I would have said that the cop was wrong in what he did. But when it comes to regular people, they're not trained in how to deal with that stuff. And if cops can't deal with it, they shouldn't be cops, first of all. But regular people aren't trained in how to deal with that stuff. Now, I'm not saying that they should be able to just go around, you know, because they're scared and shoot somebody. But people have the right to defend themselves. And somehow, this is how much of an agenda it is and how much they show that it's agenda, that it's an agenda that they're trying to push, is with the Jordan Davis case when they had brought up Stand Your Ground. Because obviously, Stand Your Ground had nothing to do with that. That was some fucking lunatic, really, who was, I mean, who started shooting at multiple people, from what I understand, because they were playing music loud. So that guy was a fucking nut, and he went to jail. So they tried to tie the two cases together somehow, because the whole idea was, let's get rid of this law. We don't want people to be able to defend themselves. And you got to go back to the fact that if you want to live in a free society, maybe you don't. And I'm sure a lot of people don't, unfortunately. And the government seems to be pushing more and more with their government media, government schools, and all of their bullshit. They seem to be pushing more and more to brainwash people into this, well, we need this for safety and we need this for safety and give up all your freedom for safety. But you have the right to defend yourself. And in the Jordan Davis case, obviously that wasn't self-defense. That was a fucking nut case. But they still tried to tie the cases together because they wanted to push this agenda about guns and about self-defense. And they still couldn't do it because it was so fucking obvious. Even in the Michael Brown case, I defend Michael Brown because Michael Brown was unarmed and you have a cop who should be able to deal with that situation. I don't know what exactly happened. I know some people say different things. But he was shot and killed by a police officer who supposedly didn't even know about the it wasn't even, from what I understand, it wasn't even a robbery. They left money, but they kind of stole it because he didn't have his ID. So technically they stole it, but left money. But still, the officer didn't even know. But that case, there's so much from this person, from that person, from whatever, that they wanted it that way. Meaning government media, fucking Democratic Party, the government. Not that the Republican Party is any better. I ain't no fucking Republican. But this is just a case that has to do with Republicans. With Democrats and Democratic operatives. So that's why I'm bringing them up. Republicans are just as fucked up. And they were just as much involved in this as the Democrats, though, going back and forth. You turn on Fox News, you hear one thing, then you turn on MSNBC. They let them go back and forth because they wanted to keep it going. They wanted to keep people arguing. They wanted to keep people apart. That's the main thing, to keep people apart, to make sure that people don't get together. They want people fighting amongst each other, because if you're fighting amongst each other, you're not fighting the government. And I'm not talking about physically, but if people are fighting among things like race and things that are just stupid things to fight about, at this juncture at least, that they can have that going back and forth. And they did during George Zimmerman. They had it going back and forth the whole fucking time. With Michael Brown, they had it going back and forth. They had to, you know, you'd listen to I remember I had Sirius. I got rid of it, but at the time, Sirius Patriot, they were saying how great police are. And then on the other one, they still didn't put police down that much, but they defended, you know, the Trayvon Martin thing. But even they wouldn't say a lot of negative things about police, but at least they said more. But it was just a back and forth, like, to keep it going, to keep the fight going between the two, between black people and white people. And that's all it's about. It's divide and conquer. Because if people get together like that, the government's in trouble and they know it. So I'm going to take a break, calm down a little, I guess. And when we come back, we'll talk about white privilege. Well, any privilege, for that matter. So we'll be right back after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Again, if you want to call in, Spreaker, you can just send a contact request to NonpartisanLibertyForAll, your name, where you're calling from, and what you want to talk about. Or you can call us by phone at 702-470-7664. That's 702-470-7664. And to expedite that, you can just send a text and leave a message with the same information, your name, where you're calling from, and what you want to talk about, and I'll call you right back. So we'll be right back after this. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
Hi. Good. Do I get a discount here because of my white privilege? I don't. Okay, so I've been hearing I have like white privilege, and people have been saying that to me, but I'm not sure if it gets me a discount anywhere. Okay, well, I'll figure it out. Thanks. All right. Hey, everybody, Dan Joseph with MRC TV here. White privilege, it's a term that's being used a lot on the left right now. I kind of wanted to find out what it means. So I'm here in downtown D.C., and I'm going to try to get an African-American perspective on white privilege. Have you heard the term white privilege?
Yes.
Have you heard the term white privilege?
I
heard the term white privilege.
You mean like that article that was on the internet a few weeks ago?
Yeah, did you hear about that?
Yeah.
A lot of people are throwing this term out right now. It's white privilege. And I think what it means the white people are treated in a different way in society, and they have certain advantages that people of color don't have. Do you think that's true? Have you heard the term white privilege before?
Yes.
What do you think it means?
Well, it means basically
that by having a certain skin color, you have more access to different things like education, wealth.
Do you think there is such a thing as white privilege in our society?
Sometimes.
Okay.
It depends on who the person is or how they were brought up.
It means that they're privileged to do things that other people are not.
Like what?
Housing, jobs.
Okay, do you think that's true?
Not really.
No?
I just think it depends on how the background is already. Yeah.
Do you think there's certain... That whites have advantages, that they don't have to work less hard in society to get places than people of color?
In certain spots.
What kind of places do they need to do that?
Like Congress.
I do think white privilege is real. It's evident in the justice system.
Congress.
Yeah.
But not the White House, though.
Hey, it is what it is.
I think by electing a black president that we thought things would change, but it hasn't. It's still the same.
I think that they're in certain circumstances, yeah, I do think right. So. I think that there is oftentimes a perception that African Americans are lazy, and I think that we're starting to get this sort of perception that if you're Latin American, you must be a hard worker.
I mean, do you think I'm privileged as a white male in any ways where that other young black men or yourself isn't?
No, actually, like I said, minorities sometimes are raised by their environment, not by, you know, full families. So sometimes that may take them astray, and sometimes that may build them up to maybe work a little bit harder.
If someone robs somebody or something, the first thing is they look for the black guy or something like that. You wouldn't be suspected.
Do you think I have privileges? White privilege?
I don't know you. I have privileges. I can't.
But I am white.
Well, you know,
Probably. What privileges would you say that white people have?
If you go into a public place and you white, no mean no disrespect, but you more trustworthy.
They probably get, like, when you go try to buy a car, you may get different things, different things like working at home, cars, schooling.
Everybody has their chance to fall, and everybody has their chance to succeed. It all depends on how their life is going and which way they wanted to go.
You ever heard the term when somebody says to somebody else, like, check your privilege? Like, hey, like if somebody would say to me, check your privilege, man. You haven't heard that one? When someone would say to me, check my privilege, and I need to check my privilege, what do you think that means?
Well, it all depends, man. I mean, a lot of white people is not as bad as people claim to be. Mm. It's like the same with blacks.
White colored people is more so pleasant, nice.
You're very pleasant and nice. I would never assume that you weren't.
Yeah, but...
Do you think it's a serious problem in America, white privilege?
Yes, I think that's why it keeps the two races separate. Because one feel like they have privilege over the other.
They move up quicker in the workplace.
You think so?
I think so.
Do you have white people at your workplace that you've seen move up more quickly than you? Yeah. And you think it's because you're black?
Yes.
White male comes in. He's not judged on his color. He's given the opportunities more often because of his skin color as opposed to a black man, because there may be some other preconceived conception or perception about him.
Do you think they get things over you, not just maybe here, but in other parts of society because of their whiteness?
Not their whiteness, but how much money they have.
He probably doesn't, because he is a black. So he don't know. Everything is, like, handed to him.
Everything.
So to speak.
I get everything.
Most of the things.
All the things.
So do you believe in the white privilege theory?
It's got a lot of evidence behind it. If you look at the statistics, Bill, they're alarming. And I did a little research before the segment, just to tick off a few for your viewers. Black unemployment rate in Ferguson is 3 times the white unemployment rate. Black men between the ages of 16 and 24 have an almost 50% unemployment rate. For whites, it's 16%. In the United States, a black child is almost 4 times as likely to live in a poor neighborhood as a white child is. 20% of white kids are in single-parent homes. 52% of black kids are. The incarceration rate is 6 times higher for blacks than it is for whites. There's segregated housing in Ferguson. There's underperforming schools. Both of those correlate strongly with low prospects in life. And this area, St. Louis, has a noticeably disadvantaged situation when it comes to folks who were born poor getting out of poverty over the course of their life. Places like Seattle, you got a real shot at it. Places like St. Louis, not so much. All of that, and not to mention in 2008, the Bureau of Justice stats came out with this figure. Blacks are almost three times as likely as whites to be subjected to force or threatened with it by police. All of that explains the numbers by Pew that show that just 18% of blacks are confident in this Michael Brown investigation. 52% of whites are. 65% of blacks say the cops went too far. 33% of whites do. Those numbers are all correlated, Bill. They are all correlated.
All right. Now, let me challenge the stats here. Number one, you have a black attorney general who's basically running the investigation, so I don't know why African-Americans wouldn't have confidence in that. Eric Holder has, in the past, made it quite clear.
He's running a satellite. He's running a satellite investigation, but right now...
But you and I both know that Holder will call the shots here, and he has the bully pulpit. Number two...
And Holder, the viewers should know, his DOJ was actually cited for misconduct in an investigation against cops down in New Orleans. So there you have the opposite problem. You know, I mean, there's a question about whether Holder can be fair to law enforcement.
But I'm dealing with the African-American perception that justice won't happen here, right, which I think is a myth. Secondly, the Asian-American community is not a troubled situation. As everybody knows, their academics are better than whites. Okay? They have language to overcome, while black Americans don't. It all comes down to families, culture, personal responsibility, all of these things, which we don't hear anything more much about. And this is what drives the poverty.
But it's not just families and culture.
The Asian success story.
Look, it's not just families and culture. I agree with you. I mean, the stats I was giving you about single parent homes and so on, that's all relevant. I mean, the double parent home is very helpful. It's
big. That's big.
It's big, but it's not just family culture. I mean, look at that stat about the black children, four times as likely to live in poor neighborhoods as white children. And in the St. Louis area, there is documented white flight. The blacks, as they move out to these suburbs like Ferguson, the whites take off. These become black neighborhoods. The schools, they get forgotten. And the black population feels forgotten, Bill. That's why they feel resentful. They don't believe the justice system is going to give them a fair shake. They don't believe the economic system is going to give them a fair shake. President Obama made all sorts of promises that didn't come true. Their Democratic governor in Missouri made all sorts of promises that didn't come true. They have very few people to trust.
All right. And I agree with all of those statements. But nothing will get better in this country until the culture changes. And the culture is you can do it. And here's what you have to do.
I understand
in order
that.
To succeed.
Self-empowerment.
Right?
And what
and
they
if
don't
that
need
doesn't
in this
change,
case. What they don't need
government
in this case.
And white people can change.
What they don't need in this case or in any case is people like Al Sharpton going in there and declaring, as a matter of fact, that that Michael Brown didn't use any deadly force or pose no deadly threat to the.
How's it going, people? I did post a video on YouTube, on Facebook. But Facebook removed it. They didn't give me no notification. Because normally if somebody reported your post or report anything, Facebook will send you a notification. Hey, somebody reported your photo. Or somebody reported your video. Facebook didn't do that. They just removed my video. So Facebook is trying to silence me because I speak too much truth. But it's okay though, Facebook. I still love y'all. But I'm just going to put my YouTube link. I'm just going to post it on YouTube and put the link at the bottom of this video. So y'all remove this video. It doesn't matter. People got my link. They still going to share my video. My word going to get out. My voice will be heard. I'm promoting this All Lives Matter movement. I'm gonna tell you why. Because it's all this Black Lives Matter movement only promotes racism, and now they encouraging black people to go kill white people because they want white people to feel what we felt 400 years ago. Newsflash: was you living 400 years ago? No. Was those, you know what I'm saying? Was you born 400 years ago? No. So how you gonna let something in the past that you never existed, that you was never born in, affect how you live your life today, having that much influence over you today? All lives matter. That police officer that got killed by that black man because that black man listened to what y'all was saying by going out and killing white people, that police officer's life mattered. That 9-year-old girl in Ferguson, Missouri that got shot in the head while she was doing all homework in a drive-by shooting that none of y'all protested, her life mattered. And y'all get mad, and then y'all slander me, y'all call me Uncle Tom and all that type of stuff, house nigga, whatever. Man, take this out. I had drill instructors in boot camp that had better insults than y'all. So, but when you next, so come up with some better insults and then get back at me. And I'm telling you the reason why I don't have a lot of black supporters. The reason why I don't have a lot of black supporters, I'm telling you the God honest truth. The reason why I don't have a lot of black supporters is because black people can't accept the truth about themselves. Black people admitting to the truth is like them snitching on themselves. And black people had this no snitching rule. So I'm not going to have them in black supporters because they can't openly admit the truth. They're going to deny till they die. But they're going to use something that happened 400 years ago against white people. They're going to hold it against them. Those white people, that's living today in this day and age, this generation, they didn't live 400 years ago. They wasn't born 400 years ago. So how you going to blame them for some stuff that happened 400 years ago that they was never born, that never existed on this planet? How? That is so crazy. All lives matter. Okay, check this out. I'm gonna tell you something. Y'all talk about black people been fighting for our civil rights and stuff like that. White people fought for our civil rights also. But you know what I'm saying? Before y'all start throwing stuff out, do research. Let's talk about. Do you know about the three civil rights activists that got killed in Mississippi? It was two white guys and a black guy. They got killed. That black guy life mattered. Those two white guys, their life mattered. They supported Martin Luther King and everything. You know why they supported Martin Luther King? Because they see the same thing that Martin Luther King see. They only see human beings. They care. They wanted to make a change. And they died. And there's other white people that died for our rights too. So don't say right there and say that's black people that died for our rights. There was white people that died for our rights too, because there was white people that supported Martin Luther King. There was white people that supported Malcolm X. There was white people that actually cared. This racism has to stop. And y'all want to blame white people for the stuff that's going on today? No. The reason why a lot of black people is locked up because black people do dumb crimes. When you go kill somebody with a pair of shoes, that's a dumb crime.
I want to address what I consider to be an extremely pretentious and insulting phrase.
Check your privilege.
We all know what that really means. Shut up. Up until now, check your privilege has been mostly used by leftist bloggers and professors. However, it's blown up recently because Time.com published an article from a white male Princeton student who says he's not a fan of the phrase, and rightfully so. Needless to say, he got attacked by the leftist blogosphere. Privileged boy! According to a writer on the website Jezebel, who responded to his article, when someone says, check your privilege, what they mean is embrace and admit that you have preconceived notions and a specific world perspective, and to set those aside for a second and just listen. But wait a minute. When you tell somebody to check their privilege, aren't you, in fact, making a preconceived notion about that person? You're basically saying, no, I deem you too privileged to have an opinion. Discussion ended. How do you even know that person is privileged? You just look at their physical appearance and say, you must be privileged. Believe it or not, people get defensive and insulted when you tell them they're privileged when you don't know a dang thing about who they are or their story. The knowledge problem applies here. Maybe you do not possess the proper knowledge to make a judgment call about a person. Some would call it super arrogant to make assumptions about the struggles or advantages that a person faces when you don't know them like that. I certainly don't know what this white man faces in his daily life. There are tons of unique factors that make up a person. You can't just reduce somebody to their skin color or their body parts. And for gosh sakes, don't make people feel guilty about things they have no control over. The question that I have is, how are we going to end sexism and racism? How are we going to get to a society that judges everyone based on their individual character and merit? That is what I want to see. And I feel like this whole check your privilege business is moving in the wrong direction. The saddest part is this privilege discussion pits people against each other. men versus women, black versus white. It creates more division, more jealousy, people pointing fingers at each other. You're privileged. No, you're privileged. All these ugly things. Yeah, people should be humble enough to recognize that they don't know what it's like to be in another person's shoes. But they're doing exactly that when they say, check your privilege. They're making assumptions, predetermined judgments about a person and their life. Before you tell somebody to check their privilege, how about you first check your ignorance about that person, and while you're at it, check your manners.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. So check your privilege. I'd actually never even heard of that shit until, I don't know, I was reading something, but I never heard it like from another person. I heard it from maybe it's more something people in college or high school are saying or something, but I had read about it or some shit. So there's like the check your privilege more oriented at just anybody. And I don't mean anybody being anybody. I mean, because of something else besides being white. And then there's, of course, white privilege saying, well, because you're white, and I think that's where it started, because you're white, you automatically have privileges that other races don't, which that can be the case in certain circumstances, I guess, but it all depends on the person. I think that I understand the concept, but you're really getting into a whole big area when you say that, because then you get into all of this other shit, right? So, for example, take a beautiful black woman and take Halle Berry or something when she was younger. I know she's getting old. I mean, she's still pretty, but She's getting old there. She's not that old. I think she's in her 40s somewhere. But take her at her, like, whenever she was at her best. I don't know. Maybe when she was, like, 25. Or I remember the first movie I think I seen her in was this movie called Strictly Business with Tommy Davidson. And I don't remember this guy's name, but he was the guy who played the husband of Lisa Bonet on The Cosby Show, if anybody remembers that. I'm sure they play reruns of The Cosby Show. He was Raven Simone's dad. And not that I have anything against lesbians or anything. It's just, I don't know, it's just weird to see her grow up and this little cute kid, and now she's like, not that she's a lesbian is what I mean. It's like she's kind of eccentric, sort of, like how she dresses and stuff, at least the pictures I've seen. So it's like you see this little cute kid, and you knew when she was little that she was going to be, and this probably sounds bad, but you knew when she was a little kid, you know, she was a little cute kid, but probably when she grew up, she'd probably be a beautiful girl when she grew up. But anyway, that kind of, well, I don't think that sounds bad, because I didn't look at her like that. It's just like you can tell, well, that's not always the case, because sometimes you have cute kids and they turn out being ugly adults. So that's not always the case. But But anyway, that has nothing to do with what I was talking about. My point being that if you take Halle Berry, who is black, although she is very light-skinned, so I think she's mixed, and you take her against some redneck white guy who is on welfare and living in a fucking trailer, and you're going to tell me that he has more privilege, he's privileged over Halle Berry because he's white, and that her looks themselves aren't enough to give her a privilege over not only a redneck white guy, over a bunch of white girls, too. So that's why the whole concept does not make any sense, because essentially when you get into this white privilege, there's so many other things that go with it. Now, if you want to go back to my scenario of, okay, the average black person, like it's harder for them than the average white person. And let me just say this to be clear, okay? Sometimes, you know, I look at a lot of this stuff and shit that people are saying, and I don't pay attention to government media as far as taking it seriously. And I pretty much don't watch it, but I need to more probably. But sometimes I'll find articles and whatnot from papers that I would consider quote unquote government media. But I actually do need to watch it more just to, like, I try to stay out of what would be called anything trendy, American trends, because they're all bullshit. However, it probably would improve my show if I covered some of these fucking things, unfortunately. Because, like, I don't know how many people listen to the show Making of a Murderer about Stephen Avery, who went to jail for 18 years, then got out, then he said he was framed and went back to jail. I did a show on that. And I guess because that show was so popular, I didn't realize the show was popular. I just watched it. And then when I went through doing research, I noticed, well, there's tons of YouTube videos that are out about the show. And I got like 100 and damn, last time I checked, close to 170 listens. And I haven't had that in a while since I probably went over to Spreaker. Well, maybe we had that. No, not 170, over 100. But so, which isn't a lot. In the big scheme of things, that's not a lot at all. Just because I haven't been getting, ever since I moved over, I haven't been getting the promotion and the, well, there's also other reasons too that certain people that are out there trying to, and I know this sound this sounds like a, you know, paranoid, crazy person, but this is actually true, that there's a couple people that are trying to sabotage my show that locally in Las Vegas. So fuck them. But really for no reason, just because they're fucking nuts. But I don't believe I get as much promotion and get to promote the show as much as I'd like to, because I don't know if it's, and this is possible, it could be just that I suck, or the topics suck, or people don't want to, you know, the main goal was to, or is, it still is, to promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty, and it's better to get those ideas out to people that haven't heard them than just have, you know, people that are in my little circle, I guess, you know, my Facebook friends or whatnot, that agree with a lot of the stuff anyway to listen. But they might just turn it off because they don't want to hear that stuff. So I don't know if it's a matter of, I mean, I don't think that I suck. So I don't think it's a matter of me sucking, but it might be a matter of, well, you're not good enough to carry a show. Or it could be just that not enough people know about it. And that's definitely a possibility. And or of the people that know about it, they just don't have the time, or the time that they did listen to it, it was a bad show or whatever. So because I've heard people just to and this isn't to insult them, but the show that I had on my other original show, they got a lot more listens. Now, I got that many listens before on other shows in the time that I've been doing the show. You know, when you first start out and if you really promote it, which we did with their show, and basically all their friends listened, it's going to drop off. It's not going to continue on that. And it did. We did the show 2 weeks and it dropped. The first one was like 160 and then it dropped to 100. And it probably would have continued dropping and then leveled off. But who knows where it would have leveled off. But the show sucked. I mean, they were, I think it had a lot of potential. And I think if they really actually put in the time and tried to do a good job and actually gave a fuck about the show, that they would have got better and they would have been pretty good. But I mean, at the time they did it, the show sucked. The people weren't listening because they were talented and because they were doing a great job. The people listened, and who knows how long they listened. I mean, just because it says, you know, 100 listens, it doesn't mean 100 listens to the whole show. It means they could have listened for 5 minutes. But the point being is that it was more of a popularity contest where I'm somebody who doesn't have all those connections or that amount of Facebook friends or whatever. So that may be that people just don't know me, and they did. I did get a lot more listens on Blog Talk Radio, I think, because they advertised it better. But my point being, sorry, I went off on a whole long story there. My point being is that because of that topic, because of that show, Making of a Murderer, I got, you know, so many listens off of that because of the subject. So I'm sitting there now, and I know I had written an article the day before or a couple days before. So I don't know if that had anything to do with it, neither. If that put it in a higher position, meaning if you're searching, that it put it in a higher position because I wrote an article. I honestly don't know. And, you know, posting, which I was doing, posting shows on my website would be the best way to go, because if I put in the right keywords and stuff like that, people would probably find my shows and I'd probably get a lot of listens that way. So that's something else I need to do. But my point there, I guess, was, what was my point? I think my point there was that I don't know really still at this point what makes somebody listen to a show and what makes somebody not. And that was kind of off topic, but I kind of got into that. But anyway, going back to this privilege, I mean, the reason why it just philosophically doesn't work. And again, the only way I see it working is in what I said. In general, you'd say that it's easier for white people to make it than black people in general. But again, you look at this day and age, and that's what I was about to get into. And like, you look at this guy who got screwed over in the show I did. I mean, he was a white guy. He was just, you know, considered white trash, you know, a poor white, you know, piece of shit as far as the cops looked at him. But first of all, as I was saying earlier, there is no way that things are worse now than they were 50 or 60 years ago. That's just a given. I don't think anybody would argue with that. And I'm talking about when, you know, maybe in the North and the West and everywhere but the South, I guess. And I don't know what states were considered the South. I would think Virginia to Texas, but I don't know how much of Texas would be considered that kind of South. And the rest of the country, how bad it was, and remember that, you know, Brown versus Board of Education was in 1954, so, and that was in Massachusetts. So there was still segregation going on, you know, separate but equal. But how fucked up is that to separate people just based on race? It is. It's something that actually changed me a lot, as in, because someone was saying in one of these videos, and I haven't played it yet, because I don't remember which one, but that they didn't learn about shit like this in school. And I remember in eighth grade. Now, again, I went to junior high in Massachusetts, but I remember in eighth grade, we went into detail in the slavery. And the only thing I remember the teacher saying that I really disagreed with is John Brown, who was, he's a receiver for the Phoenix Cardinals, Arizona Cardinals, but he was also a guy who went and freed slaves and killed white people. And I remember relating to him later when I was in high school, you know, and I hung out with all the black kids and everything. And I still do. Because I think he was killed. He was arrested and killed because he murdered people. But I believe that they deserved it. You know, and all of the, my teacher at the time, I remember him saying that the heads of these revolts, you know, Gabriel Prosser was one of them, Nat Turner, and I believe there was one more. And I know John Brown just like went down there and then just, I don't remember the specifics. I know he went and freed slaves and killed people. And I couldn't see myself not doing the same thing, to be honest. Like coming down there, well, they didn't have the same type of guns they have now, but coming down there with like an AR-15 and just like fucking, I think differently. So I would try not to kill the people that were the slave owners unless I saw them like do something really bad. But I would just like tie them up or something and free everybody. It's like, and that, now in the video we just listened to, he made an interesting point where he said, okay, you're talking about, you know, 200 years ago and you can't blame people. And really, in a way, he's right in the sense that no one alive today was alive back then. So how can you, or even realizes what it was really like? I think the majority of America is pretty ignorant when it comes to that. And just because people years ago were like that, hundreds of years ago, I don't think that means that people today owe anybody anything. I think that the slave owners owed, when the slaves were freed, they owed them something, and it was supposed to be 40 acres and a mule. And they all should have been set up with something. Fuck, they should have took, if they couldn't afford it, they should have took their farms and their plantations, because essentially all these people were rich. I guess if they owned like 100 slaves or 50 slaves, I don't know how you divide it up, but you know, somehow you'd work it out. But I don't see, it's almost like the banks in the bailout or something. Like, they, as far as I know, now from what I understand is that Lincoln wasn't going to be that hard on the South. And then Andrew Johnson came in and he was really hard on the South. And the rationale was that that just made them madder and there was more animosity. And even though your first reaction is, okay, we need to punish these people, that might not be the best idea. But as far as I know, nobody went to jail. I mean, I guess the troops that fought against them may have. I didn't get into that much of detail, or we did and I don't remember it. But as far as what happened during slavery, I mean, that really affected me, you know, when I was 13 years, was I 13 years old in eighth grade, and hearing all that and how that could go on and how people could treat people like that. And I always thought, you know, even being half Jewish, which was worse for America, slavery or the Holocaust? And I said slavery, you know, in my own mind. But for America, which was worse for the world? I guess I would say the Holocaust, because you killed 6 million people and put them in, you know, the way that they killed them, the gas chambers. But I honestly rather be dead than be a slave. So it depends how you look at it. But definitely for America, that's something that is just so bad. And I don't think people realize how bad it is. But at the same time, it has been over 200 years, but because what? You know, 1863, if you want to count it from them, really. If you really want to be fair about it, you know, 1870, to get everything together and, you know, make sure everybody was free and whatnot. So, because the war ended in 1865. So, it's been, you know, not even 200 years, but it's been long enough where everybody's dead. And I just, it's hard for me to comprehend that people could actually do that to other people. But then at the same time, and I know none of the people I was related to had anything to do with it, because I can trace back to, you know, my father's mother's parents escaped Russia when they were becoming communists. And she had said something about they were originally from Spain or something. I don't know. And then, you know, my father's father on his side, he came over from Germany sometime in like 18 something. And they all lived in, you know, I'm originally from Boston, so there wasn't slavery there anyway. But even somebody that was, I mean, that's not their fault. People have relatives they don't like. They have, immediate relatives that they can't stand. So you can't hold anybody responsible for that. So I think dwelling on that, and nobody alive today was a slave neither. So, and even the people in the 60s in the South, some of them are still alive, but most of them were little kids. But the majority of adults and people that had to experience that, most of them are dead by now as well. So, you know, looking at it that way and looking at the progress that has been made, you know, that Black people have the exact same opportunities that white people have. Again, it may be a little harder. I mean, look, there's a Black president. Now, that doesn't mean that racism doesn't exist. So just because there's a Black president, you can't go to, well, racism doesn't exist because we have a Black president. No, that doesn't mean anything. Well, I wouldn't say it doesn't mean anything. Let me take that back. It does mean something. If a Black person can get elected president, it does mean something. Now, it doesn't mean that racism doesn't exist, but it definitely means that there's been, when it comes to that, there's been so much progress. And now what should be done now? Because I think basically the government should totally stay out of it. The government was the ones that had the fugitive slave law that were returning slaves. The government were the ones that let slavery exist in the South. The government were the ones who let slavery exist when they signed the fucking Constitution. So I know they did it for some greater good so they could have some union of the fucking states. Which did what? What did it do? It got us where we're at now, where everything is fucked up, where we're moving towards a government being involved in every aspect of your life, which, again, people that listen to me know that I don't believe in government. I think government, by definition, is about control. It's about controlling people. So instead of having each state be its own country, they compromised things like that, where you'd have a few countries that had slavery that hopefully would have just died out, as opposed to a country that accepted it. And it's crazy. But if you go to now, people can sit and dwell on the past and say, well, this happened and this happened and that happened. Or they can do something now for their future. Again, no one was alive when slavery happened. And most of the people when what happened in the 60s happened. And they don't know, you know, kids today don't know what racism is, I think. I think most kids today don't know really what racism is. They just throw that word around. They throw it around like, you know, it's nothing. And it hurts a lot of people. When you get called a racist, that's a huge thing. And to just throw that around, it is not okay. And if I get to it, I got somebody who, there's no doubt in my mind, this person is a racist. I'm not throwing around shit. But to jump so quickly to that, you know, you're talking about people that were owned by other people, that were beaten, that were killed. And then you're talking about everything up from that time until the 60s, and I don't know what went on in between. I mean, I remember going through history, but I don't remember anything standing out that when that happened in between. But even if you say it was the same for all that time, which I assume it was in the South, all that and all those people, you know, again, the majority of them aren't alive anymore. And they experienced real racism where people could actually tell them what to do because a government would back it up. If a black man hit a white man back, it would probably be the black man who got arrested. That's not the case anymore. I mean, I'm not saying that that might be a bad example because you're dealing with the police. But in general, it's not the case where black people don't have these opportunities. There's nothing that a white person can do that a black person can't do. Now, it might be a little harder for them to do it based on their situation, but it might not be. They might be in a better situation than a lot of white people. They may have, and they may be in a situation where they're poorer than a white family, but their family is more loving, and the white family treats their kids like shit, and they grow up to be all fucked up. You know, people don't think of things like that neither when they think of white privilege. They don't think about the kids whose family or father was an alcoholic and a drug addict and maybe beat them or fucked them all up mentally. They just think, oh, you're white, so you somehow have some kind of privilege. People are going to look at you in what way? That, oh, well, they'll hire you for a job first? Maybe, maybe not. It depends on your attitude. It depends on the way you dress. And that comes up, too, to say that, well, we're discriminated against for the way we dress. Now, that's not really discrimination, and I went through that when I was in high school and right after, and probably even now a little. I don't know. Nobody says anything to me, but I've noticed people following me around stores and shit like that, you know, because I don't wear tight pants, and I, like I said, I usually wear like a football shirt or whatever, and when I'm not working, when I am, I will wear like a dress shirt or whatever, but I've experienced that as well. So, and what it comes down to also is, what do people want? Do they want the government to come in? Because I think that the government would love to do this and pass hate speech laws and pass general hate laws or general whatever kind of laws to... I mean, Obama has already established a agency to go and check the amount of white people in a neighborhood or the percentage of black people or things like that. Now, it's one thing if black people are discriminated against and they can afford a house and somebody won't sell it to them because they're black. And that, I'm sure that happens. But, and I don't really think it happens too much where I'm at. But, you know, I'm just in one city in the country. Just because, you know, especially my street is all mixed. But I'm sure it happens. But you get to a point where, one, I don't think any of the government bullshit should exist anyway, because I don't think the government should exist. And that's a whole nother story on how you could handle things and whatever. But, and I don't have all the answers, but I have some. Just like they have so many things now that doesn't work. So we already know all this shit that doesn't work based on the government. The majority of it doesn't work. So then they'd want to question me. Well, how would you do this and how would you do that? Well, look at how you do it now. It sucks. But what I'm saying is that what do people want? How far, one, do you want the government to go? Because even if I agreed with the government and supported the government, you can't go any further between affirmative action and all of these other laws. If you're discriminated against, there's actions that you can take. So how many more laws do you need? Now, it seems like Obama wants to force people to be together or force diversity or force our neighborhoods to make sure, like quotas or something. And you only have a certain percent of the population anyway, but to have quotas on neighborhoods, to have the government to control it to that point. So you don't have the right to really choose where you live. Now, for me personally, I don't, as long as the people respect me and don't, you know, fuck with me or whatever, I don't give a fuck what race lives on my street. I honestly, my ideal would be a mixed amount of people. I wouldn't want to live in an all-white area neither. I just don't fit in an all-white area. I'd want a mixed area with all kinds of people, with all races of people. But the whole thing is, what is the goal here? Now, I can see on the justice system side things to do. And most of those things, because you're not going to get them to change, but if you get rid of laws, you get rid of drug laws. Well, police can't really search your vehicles anymore because what are they usually looking for? Drugs. So that's gone. If you get rid of, if you get rid of police altogether, but I'd have to go into more detail on that. But that's something right there. It's not adding more laws. It's getting rid of laws. It's the government who is the most oppressive. It's the injustice system that is the most oppressive. But there's things you can do to make sure you stay out of the justice system by changing the laws. Because if drugs were legal, then no one's going to end up in the justice system for drugs. Because they can't arrest you for them. It's less government that's needed. It's less government, less police. That is really going to help people. It's not just going to help black people. It's going to help everybody. Because it's not just black people going to jail. Now, yes, there are a lot of black people going to jail, especially for bullshit charges. I was in jail waiting to get bailed out. And the majority of people there, of course, black, in there for bullshit charges. We're not talking about fucking hardened criminals. We're talking about, oh, I didn't pay a ticket for weed and for jaywalking. One guy lost his job, was in jail 5 days because, of course, it takes that long to fucking process you. And he had a jaywalking ticket, didn't pay it. And this wasn't somebody lying about what happened. I mean, because that's what it was. It was the city jail. And to be in the city jail, you have to do something that is not that bad. That's a misdemeanor, unless they're moving people over, so that's possible. But so I don't think there's anything more that can be done laws-wise. There's things that can be done repealing laws. Get rid of fucking jaywalking tickets. Get rid of tickets altogether. definitely change drug laws so there aren't any. You have the right to put what you want in your body. If I asked any of you out there right now listening, which I know live is probably like two people, if that, but if you're listening to the archive, you know, ask yourself, who owns you? And make sure that your answer is yourself. You own yourself. And then that leads to a whole bunch of other things. You owning yourself. But looking at this, and I'll get back to the whole white privilege thing, but looking at like Black Lives Matter, and it's really like, what the fuck do they even want? And if they want to get together as a group and go out and build a black community, and when I say a black community, I mean specifically a community that the majority of people there are black, and build up a black community, or maybe they already live in a black community, and build up their community, and, you know, I don't think voting makes a difference, but if they want, they could all get together and vote in all black mayor and city council people, and that's what they did in Baltimore. Of course, didn't seem to make much of a difference, but because to me, it's not through voting. But it looks like through a lot of the things that the government has done and is doing, that, yeah, they want to force you. It's like the school system where they bust people in some places and force people to go to certain schools and things like that. And I don't have a problem with the busing people in if that's where they want to go, but with the forcing people to get bused someplace else, that I guess would be the problem I have. So it's like taking neighborhoods and the government, not people themselves, integrating neighborhoods if they're not integrated, or if they decide, well, there's only, you know, two black families in this neighborhood of 20 houses. We need to move more black families in and have the government be in charge of that, because that's what they're studying. That's not freedom. And I know when it comes to, and again, of course, I think this applies more to older people because things have been getting better for years. But still, it doesn't mean, you know, racism still exists. So, but it's more the type of racism of somebody will follow you around the store, which I've had happen to me before as well. Or, you know, maybe somebody will, you know, call somebody a nigga or something, which is still bad, but it might be in the context of an argument. That doesn't make it okay. But what I'm saying is things like beatings and murders and scaring people to stay in their place, that doesn't exist. And if it does, please give me an example of where that exists. I mean, maybe depending on where you live, there might be kids that are picked on. There's also a lot of white kids that are picked on by black kids as well. So it's not a, you know, the kids picking on kids is something different. But I'm talking about is the opportunity where years ago, black people were scared to stand up. They were scared to do certain things. They didn't have the same opportunities. So that's where I'm kind of asking with Black Lives Matter, because obviously, you know, it's not about the police exactly what they want. It almost sounds like they want some kind of segregation, and that's up to them. That's their choice as well. If a group of black people wanted to get together and start their own community, they have the right to do that as well. Again, it's called freedom. And for the most part, again, there's still, you know, especially with the justice system where black people do get harsher punishments and don't get the, I think, is treated as well by the justice system now. That's becoming a, I think, for everybody. I mean, I've never been treated well by the justice system neither, maybe once. I got screwed over on a bullshit fucking case where I couldn't even have a jury, and the judge, after seeing bruises all over me, pictures of them, admitting that the officers did it, still said, oh, you're guilty. And you know what I was supposedly guilty of? Purposefully stopping them from conducting or inhibiting them from conducting their investigation. And the way I supposedly did that, and I did it intentionally, is what they said, because they asked me to get out of my car and said no. And that's not what even happened. So we are getting more to a point where we are all getting fucked over as a people. Not just as a race or specific races. And in order to achieve freedom, we all need to stand up. And I'm not talking about the Republican bullshit definition of freedom. I'm talking about true freedom and liberty. I'm talking about the government not telling you what to do or being involved in your life in any way. But in order to achieve that, people need to band together. So anyway, back to white privilege. I mean, I think I pretty much covered all of it. I mean, there's so many things that it can be judged on. If a girl is fat and ugly, I mean, that sounds mean. I think I talked a little about white privilege before, but it goes to all of these things, you know, single parent households compared to two parent households. The statistics is something like, I forget the specifics, but it's ridiculous, really, the amount. I mean, how important it is to have both parents, because the statistics of the results of not having both parents are really bad. The things that kids end up doing. Now, I'm not saying stay together with somebody just to be with them for the kids, because that's probably even worse. But if you have kids, try to have them with somebody that you're going to be with. There's too many people that are just having kids, that are having kids at, you know, 16, 17. And I know some of them. And usually it's not just one either. It's more than that. And it's sad. I mean, it already puts you behind everybody else. And what about that? Is that a privilege compared to somebody who doesn't have a kid at 17? So since we have 15 minutes left, I wanted to talk about this one more thing. And I've talked about this person before. I've been watching their show occasionally more the past couple weeks to hear what they say, because it seems like every show it's worse and worse regarding the amount of racism. And this is definitely racism. You know, there's a difference between maybe being harsh or coming out and having an opinion about certain things that may involve race. But to say things like you're trying to preserve the white race because one studies show that they have higher IQs and you wouldn't want a society that's all mixed races, that you want some kind of purity of the white race. To me, right there, I mean, that's what the Ku Klux Klan and those Nazi groups are based off of. They want the purity of the white race. It's not just about hate with them. I think it's less, hate's there, but I think it's more about they want to preserve their white genes and the white race. And you have somebody who's on the radio getting like 1,500 listeners per show. And there's actually fucking people that listen to this shit and buy into it. You know, I can come out like I did today and be honest about things and say how, you know, say what I said about Black Lives Matter. Because, you know, I'm just being honest and being real. But to, you know, actually care about preserving the white race and genes and because of, in your mind, what the white race has supposedly done and how they have higher IQs, and that society would eventually end if everybody ended up mixed. And my, you know, I mentioned my fiance is Mexican, so she wants to have kids. I'm unsure, not because she's Mexican, but because just I'm unsure about having kids, because just all the work. I mean, I have animals, and but I mean, I always wanted to have kids when I was younger. It's just about being ready for them. So at some point after we get married, we'll probably have kids and they'll be half Mexican and part Jewish, I guess, and part white. And I don't give a fuck. I think they'll be beautiful because they'll be of those, you know, mixed races, and hopefully get the best part of all of them. But, you know, every time, you know, people will call into the show when they talk about black people, they'll just use the word nigga like it's nothing to put people, black people down. And this same person doesn't think there's any racism. Oh, no, there's no racism. Racism doesn't exist. Well, what do you think your show is? It's like a white power show. And this was a guy who I actually had on my show before way before this, before he actually became, you know, a part of the Klan or a white power group or whatever, he went on some show that I think was a white power show. So I guess he's down with the Nazis or something. He's basically a conservative. I mean, he doesn't believe in true freedom and liberty. There's no fucking way, because he only believes in true freedom and liberty for white people, if he even believes in that. So it's just been, and I can't listen to the fucking show anymore anyway. And I hadn't in like a month, and then I had like the past couple weeks, just because, you know, especially with this show, I wanted to hear what the fuck was going on over there. And it's just, it's crazy. But it doesn't surprise me, because I could always see that type of shit in him, man. You know, I thought he was, at first, I thought he was a nice guy. He was on Free Talk Live, and he was calm. And he got a bad rap, I thought, because he would talk about, you know, the police. When the police died, he'd celebrate it or whatever. And I didn't have a problem with that, to be honest. I mean, I don't support that, but I didn't have a problem with, if that's how he felt, then that's how he felt. And I didn't have a problem with that. So that was the, I guess, offensive stuff that he said. And that's nothing compared to what he's saying now. So, and now it seems like he supports the police. So, I don't know. It's scary in the sense that to even have something like 1,500 people, you know, listen per show, and that's on his YouTube channel. Maybe not that many that get on there. Maybe 1,000 or something, but I don't know if he, I'm sure he gets listens from other, you know, applications that he has out there that just play the radio. And yeah, of course, he gets a lot more than me, a lot more. And whatever, you know, he could say whatever he wants. I don't think he'll even hear about it, because, again, my show doesn't get anywhere near the listeners that he does. And that's what scares me. Not that I don't get the listeners, but that somebody like him that says all this shit. Now, you could have a bunch of people that listen to him because they don't like him. Like, I listen, I think the show's a train wreck. I mean, I think that as a broadcaster, I don't think he's the worst broadcaster in the world, but he's sitting there. He reminds me of Mark Levin, kind of. He's sitting there screaming and just, I don't know. It's not like he's a stupid guy neither, although he comes off that way sometimes. So I think he thinks he's a lot smarter than he is, but he's not stupid. So, yeah, I don't know. And it's I should just name the show. It's Radical Agenda, Chris Cantwell. And, again, I really didn't want to name his name, because I did actually used to like him. I thought when he was on my show, he was a good guy, but the shit that he's putting out there now, I can't at all fucking, can barely listen to it. Never mind condone it. It's just like listening, you know, and I've always done this. Listen to people that I can't stand. I listen to Mark Levin on my way home. I can't fucking stand him. But it's like, I want to hear what bullshit he's going to put out there. And that's why I've been listening to this motherfucker. And it's just gone way too far with, you know, and he has the right to say it. And don't get me wrong, I support freedom of speech. He has the right to have his show on and broadcast his show. And I'm not saying it because of that. I'm saying that to have that many people actually listen to him and to have followers, it's like a bunch of racist fucking followers as well. And it's sad. I hope the majority of people listening are listening because they don't like him and they're just trying to find out what he's going to say. But I don't think that's the case because, you know, he had a following before for kind of the same reason, not being racist, but for being somewhat controversial, where he would purposely try to be controversial. I mean, that's what he did. He would say things to try to, you know, start up controversy and get listeners that way, attract attention and all that shit. So just something I had to mention. There is this clip I want to play. Check your privilege. Diversity at Michigan. It's going to go about maybe 5 minutes over the show, but I definitely got to play this. So we'll play that and then we will end the show. If I can find this. I thought I had just seen it, which made me think of it. So, here we go.
White privilege.
And checking your privilege every single day.
Oh, shoot.
First off, I would like to thank you for coming here today. I know it's very cold, and I'd like to say thank you. We support you for standing out in this unfortunate weather.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the time has come to check your privilege. In case you haven't heard, these University of Michigan students are protesting what they claim is a lack of diversity on the University of Michigan's campus. What began as a social media protest quickly spread, making national headlines. This set off a firestorm of controversy and a renewed debate in affirmative action and campus racial policies. These students claim that because only 4% of the University of Michigan students are African Americans, that this is an example, an egregious example of
institutional racism.
Ah, yes, institutional racism. Now, this ain't your granddaddy's racism, kids. You know, with its actual evil and actual oppression. No, institutional racism is so subtle and so pernicious that no single one of us is aware that it's even happening. It only manifests itself in the decisions of large institutions to keep out victimized, oppressed minority groups like these courageous revolutionary protesters.
I'm a single voice in a sea of voices that yearn to get away from the exclusion and isolation on this campus. I'm a single voice that covets true equality.
Now this young man seems like a good egg. He covets true equality. That sounds pretty damn good. But we may discover that true equality for him doesn't really mean what the rest of us think it means.
There's a fight that emerges from the clamor of broken promises and understated commitments to diversity.
Ah, diversity. There's that magic word again. It's a wonderful thing, isn't it? Unless, of course, it's not the kind of diversity that you want. And as we're soon to find out, these students aren't big fans of real diversity.
Our demands to elevate the visibility of students of color on campus, to prioritize social standing of students of color on this campus as if we are important, because we actually are important.
Well, I'm glad to see that all that heinous oppression on campus hasn't damaged their self-esteem.
And our demands are as follows.
We demand that the university give us an equal opportunity to implement change. The change that complete restoration of the BSU purchasing power through an increased budget can obtain.
boy, it's refreshing to hear a special interest group on a college campus demand more taxpayer money, especially when it's going to go to fund all that quote-unquote change we so desperately need.
We demand an opportunity to congregate and to share our experiences in a new trotter and locate our central, located on Central Campus.
Well, this just sounds like a rip-snorting idea. I can't think of a better way to spend $1 or $2 million of the taxpayers' money than to build a brand new multicultural center, where instead of doing math or computer science, kids can sit around and navel-gaze about identity politics with each other, because not enough of that happens on campus already.
Four, we demand an opportunity to be educated and to educate about the America's historical treatment and marginalization of colored groups.
I agree 100%. You know, when I was in college, I took a course where we all got in a circle and we punched ourselves in the face repeatedly for things that our ancestors did that we had nothing to do with. It was a really enlightening and culturally enriching experience for me. It would be great for the University of Michigan. But of course, all these demands for more diversity lead up to this one. The most important demand. Listen carefully.
We demand the increase in the black representation of campus to equal 10%.
10%. Well, that seems like a fair number. But the only question is, who's occupying all of these spots that black people are missing out on? It must be white people. It has to be white people. It's always white people. Because after all, that's what diversity means, right? The diminishment of the dominant, most populous people group, and the introduction of a rich tapestry of different ethnicities and backgrounds. At least that's what I think it means. So surely there's some white privilege at play here. Let's look at a demographic breakdown of the University of Michigan, shall we? This comes from Forbes.com's profile of the University of Michigan's demographics. And let's look here. They're right. 4% of the students are African American, 11% Asian, and 65% white. 65% to 4%. There it is. There's that white privilege creeping through. How can whites be so overrepresented? What, they make up 50% of the general population, right? Let's look at those numbers. Wait. Oh, dear. Oh, dear, oh, dear. I did not see this coming. 80% of the state of Michigan's population is white? This means that there are 15% fewer of the dominant people group on campus than there are in the state of Michigan. In fact, statistically, whites are underrepresented on campus. So if whites and blacks are underrepresented on campus, then it logically follows that everyone else is overrepresented. At last, we have our culprits. We can point our finger at that privileged group who's taking all of our slots. It's those first-generation immigrants, those Asians, those Indians, those enemies of diversity. Oh, wait. They happen to be the most diverse group on campus. It turns out the University of Michigan is a pretty diverse place. And just to be clear, diversity was your stated goal, right? Because I saw one of your representatives on TV, and he had this to say.
The pamphlets, they're always, this picture of diversity. It looks like a Benetton ad. That's just not the reality on the ground there, is it?
Absolutely is not the reality. From 2006 to 2012, the black population at the University of Michigan dropped almost 30%. And so, yeah, that's where we are getting at with this campaign, you know, for a school that values diversity so much, that say they value diversity so much, we really don't see it on campus.
Wait a second. You don't see diversity on a campus that has a 45% minority population? What about all the Asian students, Indian students, immigrant students, all the students that have lessened the amount of black and white students on campus? Aren't they diverse? Oh,
I guess they're the wrong kind of diverse, aren't they? That's a shame. But wait, there's one final stop on this train of hypocrisy and idiocy.
I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back and pretend.
We will be forced to engage as an entire community in ways to implement the change we request. We will allow the university 7 days to end negotiations and come to conclusions on our 7 demands. If negotiations are not complete and they are unwilling to do so, we will be forced to do more, beginning to increase violently in our activism for social progress and take physical actions on the University of Michigan's campus. Thank you.
Now, wait a minute, young lady. Did you just say physical action? Because physical action could mean anything. It could mean blocking people from entering doorways, or it could mean actual physical violence. And we have a word for people who use violence or the threat of violence for political purposes. But I'm sure you're not that kind of person, right? You're not. Surely no one has ever used these kinds of tactics on a college campus before. Oh, wait. I forgot all about the weathermen.
In a white room with black curtains.
During the occupation, they carried at least 17 rifles and guns when they left the hall. Campus police didn't try to take the guns away from them. They were allowed to keep them in their dormitories.
A man's voice said a bomb would go off in the building in half an hour.
That's right. The weathermen were a radical leftist group that started, where else? The University of Michigan in the 1960s and 70s. Amongst other things, they protested the Vietnam War by conducting a series of bombing campaigns. One of the weathermen even bombed the Capitol building. But I'm sure none of these radical crazies are working as professors at the University of Michigan. I'm sure they're not telling you all of their old tricks for how to subvert campus culture and paint yourself as an oppressed, victimized minority in order to spur social change in your own selfish direction. No, that can't possibly be the case. Oh, wait.
This legacy, the legacy of the black action movements in the 1970s.
You certainly sound like you're from the 60s or the 70s, with all your talking points.
It's a fight for the social justice.
Social justice.
Social action diversity. Do whatever is necessary.
Whatever is necessary.
Now, ain't that some shit? Whatever is necessary? Maybe I'm crazy, but that kind of sounds like a threat to me. But wait, I finally cracked it. I finally understand what all this is about. It's not about diversity at all. As we've seen, there are 15% fewer the dominant people group on campus. What are you proposing, that we don't allow Asians and Indians and immigrants in? Why? What would you have us do to get to the 10% requirement that you've arbitrarily put forward? It's not about diversity. And it's certainly not about
institutional racism.
This is about creating a new generation of political soldiers who are going to live their entire lives in the hazy bubble of far-left politics, never once letting reason or fact or personal responsibility ever once penetrate their impermeable shell. I see. You are what the Soviets used to call useful idiots. I'll conclude, then, with a simple message of hope. Dear Black Student Union at the University of Michigan, diversity is a beautiful thing. You should know. You attend a rich, diverse campus yourselves. Perhaps if you took a look around at all the other faces at your university, you'd see that it's selfish to exclude those who are qualified on the basis of their race, color, creed, or nationality. Perhaps you might ask other minority students who are doing well how they're achieving despite all that terrible white privilege in the world.
Many of them come from countries where slavery is still a reality. Yet here they are in the USA, becoming doctors and lawyers. Who knows? You might learn a thing or two from them if you were courageous enough to check your privilege.
That's all we have for tonight. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. I appreciate it. And tomorrow, we'll have Shire Dude will be joining us from New Hampshire, and we'll be talking all about hacktivists. So be sure to tune in tomorrow, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. Thanks, everybody.
We don't get the tickets. We force them. But at the end of the day, each and every man has to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force...